The screen goes black. The audience settles down. And then... The following sprawl of golden text sets up George Lucas's magnum opus, Star Wars, a film that will become the start of the most iconic and recognisable film franchise of all time, spawning sequels, prequels, spin-offs, toys, games and books. 40 years on, and with an empire of fans worldwide, there's no clear end to the Star Wars films in sight, and Star Wars is still strong as ever. But how did a pulpy, borderline B-movie manage to leave such a massive impact on our film and popular culture today? Let's rewind a bit, back to the 1970s. The 70s were an especially difficult period of time for the world. Many countries at the time were experiencing a huge increase in inflation rates and unemployment, meaning goods were getting more and more expensive for consumers. However, there was one good that didn't seem to be experiencing this price increase, and that's cinema tickets. In a world before DVDs and VHS, the only way to watch films was in the cinema. The drop of the price of tickets led to a huge excess of films like Jaws in 1975, when the average cinema ticket that year cost only $2.03. Jaws is also widely regarded as the forerunner for the summer blockbuster, a concept that in 2 years' time would be cemented as the norm.
You're gonna need a bigger boat.
In addition to this, the 1970s were experiencing somewhat of a cinematic drought in the variety of big-budget films.
Star Wars came out in 1977, which was not a great time, especially in America. All sorts of bad things happening, Vietnam War, etc. Gritty films, you know, good films, French Connection, very good, but gritty.
So the decision to create a large-scale science fiction epic was met with some deliberation, naturally. However, in spite of all of this, on May 25th, 1977, Star Wars shattered all box office records, becoming the highest grossing film ever released up till that point. The film follows the moisture farmer Luke Skywalker, who discovers that he's part of a lineage of Jedi Knights, mystical warriors who wield lightsabers and can use an energy known as the Force, and his battle against the evil galactic empire led by Darth Vader. The story of the film has often been compared to that of Campbell's Hero's Journey plot structure, commonly associated with myths and legends like Beowulf and the Odyssey. And many will put this down as the sole reason Star Wars is as accessible as it is. And this appears to be the point of view of Anthony Daniels, who played C-3PO.
I think even George doesn't know, but if you actually look into it seriously, then there are elements that do speak. His understanding, his knowledge of classic storytelling frameworks, if you like, things that have made Greek and Roman myths work. We've all always wanted stories, bedtime stories, campfire stories. George took all the elements that make stories work, and he studied them, from comic books to works of psychiatry, if you will. And he managed to mesh them together in some major way. And rather like mixing the ingredients, you know, anybody can take flour, eggs, and milk, but it depends on you. Rather like a player who becomes part of the instrument, it becomes you. And George was so seminal in there.
While this is certainly true for Luke's story, I believe there's more to the cultural impact it had than this alone. For example, each element of Star Wars seems to be an homage to the films and stories before it. To begin with, let's look at the villains of Star Wars. There's very little doubt that the design and aesthetics of the Empire were heavily inspired by that of the Nazis. From the uniforms of the officers, to the fact the Imperial foot soldiers are called stormtroopers, everything about them seems Nazi. The World War II iconography doesn't stop there either. For the storyboards of the dogfights during the climactic assault on the Death Star, real footage of Spitfires and Messerschmitts were used. The scene also took inspiration from films like The Battle of Britain and Dambusters. Others elaborate on Lucas's anti-Vietnam point of view, and see the battle against the Empire as a metaphor for the Vietnamese people's war against the machine, a point that's sure to have hit home in a country that had been economically devastated by the Cold War conflict. These references perhaps made for an experience that wasn't too alien or complex, and felt familiar to a population that had war felt still firmly on their minds. A slightly less obvious inspiration for the films came from the Japanese samurai films of the late 50s and 60s, but one seems to have a great deal more common elements than the others. The 1958 film The Hidden Fortress shares numerous plot elements with Star Wars: epic duels, a band of rebels fighting against impossible odds, a feisty female lead, and two bumbling fools leading the story. Even the iconic wipe Star Wars uses so frequently came from this film. Some also think that the age of the series has something to do with it. The franchise has been around for so long that the audience members who watched the original films have since introduced their children to the films, who have now introduced even their children to the films, becoming a sort of hand-me-down across three generations of moviegoers. Many, though, point to the simplicity of Star Wars as the main appeal. But the battle between the forces of good and evil, the swashbuckling rogue aspects of Han Solo, and above all else, the theme of family and redemption. Perhaps the late Carrie Fisher, who played Princess Leia, puts it best.
Well, it's good against evil. George's homage to every film that he ever loved. George loves films, and that's what this film is about, is movies. Every scene is in some way reminiscent of a scene in a film that we all loved before, like in High Noon there's a bar sequence, only this time it's with monsters instead of Gary Cooper. You've got The Wizard of Oz, we have a robot that looks sort of like the Tin Man. You have adventure like Robin Hood, we do swing acrosses. I guess it's going to even be like Tarzan. Buck Rogers, it's got everything in it, every ingredient. George made a movie that he wanted to see, not a movie that he thought the public would want to see, because if he thought that if he made a movie like that, we would be seeing a disaster film again or something like that, probably.
A touch of the Flash Gordon as well in this.
It's got whatever you want it to be. It's pure entertainment. It's like a roller coaster ride, and it can be interpreted as long as you enjoy it, which is the intention of it.
No matter what the reason, Star Wars saga lives on today, and it seems it won't be going away anytime soon.